everyone, and welcome to the Photoshop Show. Tonight you can catch the Photoshop Show here on G+, live on the stream of our generous broadcaster Keith Barrett, or on my stream, Jan Kabili, or the stream of my amazing co-host, Ron Clifford. Take a bow, Ron.
Hello.
Or you can go to Keith Barrett's broadcast network, vidcastnetwork.com. That's V-I-D-C-A-S-T network.com. And if you do that, you can not only watch this show live, but you also can participate in our live chat room.
Jan is awesome. That's all I can say.
And if you do that, our moderator, Ron Clifford, will catch your questions for our panelists, our guests, or even us hosts, and we really want to encourage you to participate that way. So please go to vidcastnetwork.com, even if you're watching here on G+, so that you can do the chat room with us. And later, you can go back to Vidcast Network and listen to the recording of this show, and you're going to want to do that because tonight we have a very special guest who's going to show you some very special stuff about Photoshop, and I know you're going to want to go back and look at that. And I'll also be showing you some tips and tricks about using the new Lightroom 4 that you may want to go back to, I hope so. So I would like to introduce or tell you just a bit about each of our panelists, and then I'll let them take it a little further. Tonight, our very special guest is Rich Harrington, who is an author and an educator and a longtime friend of mine from the Photoshop world. And he's a man who has one foot in Photoshop and one foot in everything video. And then we also have an amazing panel. We have Mark Rodriguez for the first time. Mark is an artist and a photographer. Hi, Mark.
Hello.
And we have Vivian Gutzwa. Did I say it right this time?
Yep, you got it.
Who's back with us again because she was so great before when we had her. And those of you who frequent G+ know that Vivian is a terrific photographer of the big city, New York City. And who else do we have? Well, we're expecting to have Helen Sotidiaras, my friend, photographer, and architect extraordinaire. And she's joining us from Greece. It's the middle of the night there, so we have to give her a little while to get up and get with us. And then, of course, we have Ron Clifford and Keith Barrett. And I'm going to let everybody tell you a little bit more about what they do, who they are, and where you can find them, both on G+ and elsewhere on the web. So let's start down at the bottom. Next to me, we have Keith Barrett, our broadcaster.
Hi, I'm Keith Barrett from keithbarrett.com and vidcastnetwork.com. I'm a 30-plus year IT technical guy currently working at the Walt Disney Company, and I, as much as possible, I live stream shows and hangouts, and I'm a pleasure to be here.
And Mark.
My name is Mark Rodriguez. I am an animator, graphic designer, photographer. Do a little bit of everything. You can find me on eclecticanima.zenfolio.com for my photography, or usually always 24 hours a day on G+. So I'm always here.
And you have an awesome goatee.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's growing in pretty good. I was the devil a couple of weeks back in a photo shoot, so I've kind of left it. So it's working out.
Go ahead.
Rich?
Sure. My name is Rich Harrington. I work for a company called Red Pixel, R-H-E-D-P-I-X-E-L, and my personal blog is richardharringtonblog.com. You can find me at your favorite bookstores or in many podcasts online. And on social media, I'm usually under Red Pixel, R-H-E-D-P-I-X-E-L.
Hey, Ron. Who are you?
Hi, Jen. I'm Ron Clifford. I'm a photographer, and I love being on here on Google+, building community and talking to everyone. I'm trying to find a way to balance that and get all my work done at the same time, like most of us. You can find me here on Google or on ronclifford.com.
It's a little hard to hear you, Ron. I don't know what that means, but you might need to...
Sure, but I'll speak up a little bit and move forward.
Do you want me to give you some of my volume?
Yeah, that was
And Vivian.
My name is Vivian Gutzwa. My main website is nythroughthelens.com. I deal specifically with New York City photography. But you can pretty much find me on Google+, since I post everything there that I would post to my website anyway.
And Helen has joined us from Greece. Hi, Helen.
Hi, Jan. Hi, everybody. I'm Helen Sotiriadis.
I'm a photographer. I'm an architect. I live in Athens. And you can find me on helensoteriadis.com or on Google+, of course.
Well, thank you all for joining us, and particularly you, Helen, for getting up in the middle of the night to join us.
I stayed up.
Even better. Thank you more. Great. So we'd like to jump right in with this show and start showing you how to do things. And most of you know that Lightroom came out. It's been 2 weeks now. And so, you know, we've had a chance to see what people have questions about. And I wanted to just address a couple of questions quick at the beginning of the show about the new Lightroom 4 for those of you who use it and those of you who are thinking about using it. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen to do that. Maybe I am. How's that look? You guys see anything yet? Like Lightroom?
Yeah, we see it. There.
Okay, terrific. Good. Okay, so what I wanted to talk about first is what happens. I've seen a lot of people asking questions about what do I do if I'm working in the new Lightroom 4 with photos that I worked on before in an earlier version of Lightroom. I'm faced with messages that ask whether I want to upgrade or not, and I don't know what to do. So here, let me suggest what to do and in what order. If you open a photo in Lightroom 4, and you see at the bottom right of the photo a little exclamation mark. I don't know if you can see that. Let me zoom into that. No, that's not going to let me zoom into that. Well, can you see down at the bottom right, you guys, panelists? There's an exclamation mark.
Yeah.
I see that.
Great. So that is sign number one that I'm working in a photo that is all set up as it was before Lightroom 4. And when I say all set up, I mean if you look over in the column on the right and at this panel called the basic panel, which is where you're going to do most of your adjustments to this photo. And we looked at the controls in the basic panel in some detail last show. You're going to see the same controls that you saw in Lightroom 3. You're going to have an exposure, recovery, fill light, and black slider, and then a brightness and contrast slider. Those, if you see that, you're not looking at what's available in Lightroom 4. The fancy name for that is the 2012 process version. But basically, it's a whole different set of sliders that gives you other capabilities, and it's really worth working with those sliders if they don't have a negative effect on the photo you're working with. So what do I mean by that? If I had taken a brand new photo, just imported it into Lightroom 4 from my digital camera, I would have no exclamation mark here. I wouldn't see this particular set of sliders. It would be all set up to go with the Lightroom 4 sliders, taking advantage of everything Lightroom 4 has to offer. That's clear, right?
Yes.
But if I open a photo like this one that I had worked with previously in Lightroom 3, then I have my exclamation mark, I have my old sliders, and I have to decide what to do. So how do you decide? Well, here's what you do. You click the exclamation mark. And when you do, this is what you'll see. A really confusing message, of course. And people don't know what to do here. So this is what I would do here. First, I would never choose Update All Film Strip Photos, because what that will do is it will look at whatever source you have selected, either a folder or a collection or maybe all the photos in your catalog in your columns on the left. And then it will, if you click that, change them all from the way that you had processed them in the old version of Lightroom, Lightroom 3 or earlier, and it'll change them so some of them may actually look different here in Lightroom 4. So I wouldn't do it on a wholesale basis like that, because there is a possibility that, that your photos will look different after you upgrade them to Lightroom 4. So instead, click this thing that says Update. Wait, I lied. Let me do that one more time. Let's go back. Okay. So again, I'm going to click the exclamation mark. Before clicking Update, here's something I would do even before that. Check Review Changes via before and after. It's also not entirely clear what's going to happen, but we'll see. Now I'm going to click Update. So now what happens is Lightroom has applied that conversion to Lightroom 4, and it's showing you how your photo is going to look with that conversion over here on the right in the after window, and it's also giving you a before window over on the left showing how that photo looked with the adjustments that you'd made earlier in Lightroom 3. Make sense?
Yep.
And so you get to now look at this and decide, gee, is this after version so different, or is it very different at all? And if it is different, is it different in a way that I like or don't like? And that's how you decide whether or not to upgrade on a photo-by-photo basis. So in this case, for example, if I scroll over here, you know, and I didn't really prepare in particular this photo, but you can see it does look quite different. Before, in Lightroom 3, I had much stronger, richer blacks, and it looks a little more saturated. Over here in the Lightroom 4 version, the shadows are opened up. You see more detail on this rock, but I don't have that same rich black and down here in the rock and the saturation in the buildings. Can you see that on your screens?
Yeah.
Okay, yep. Cool. So that doesn't mean I shouldn't upgrade, because even if I do go with the after version and upgrade, it'll be okay, because I can use the sliders in Lightroom 4 to get a lot of that punch back. But at least now I can make an informed choice about whether to do it or not. Now,
I have a question.
Go ahead.
If you don't upgrade, can you continue adjusting your image with the old sliders?
Exactly. So you're way ahead of me. That's exactly what I'm going to tell you. Somebody, by the way, is moving around and making some microphone noise, so just so that you know I can hear. So anyway, if I decide I do want to upgrade, then all I would do is come down here and click on this icon that takes me to loop view in the develop module, where I can proceed to use my Lightroom 4 sliders, my upgraded sliders. If I decide I do not want to upgrade because it changes my photo too much, I really worked on it hard in Lightroom 3, I'm not going there, then I'll do one of two things. If I remember to do it right away, I'll just press Command-Z or Control-Z for undo. But what I like to do is use the History panel, because then I know exactly where I'm backing up to. So I'll go to my History panel, which keeps track of everything that you do to any photo ever in Lightroom and never gets rid of it, even after you close Lightroom down and reopen it. And I'll click on the state just underneath the state that says Update to Current Process. So if I go back to the state right beneath that, that's how the after version will also look now, because I'm going back where I was, as Helen asked about, without any changing to the new Lightroom 4 process. And if you look at my sliders over here on the right, you see that there's still the Lightroom 3 sliders with fill light and blacks and so forth. Make sense? So that's how you get back, if you want to. Questions?
No, I'm glad you showed that.
No, I like that. I have noticed on my images, I haven't seen that kind of difference that you're noticing on that image. I'm not sure the reason, but most of my images look pretty similar with the new version as with the old version.
But it depends, Ron, on what you do. If you do some real extreme adjustments in Lightroom 3, like you really drag your recovery slider over to the right in Lightroom 3 and your fill slider as well, recovery bringing back highlight detail, fill light to bring back shadow detail, that's often when you're going to see a difference when you bring it into, it's when I've seen a difference when I upgrade to the new process version. But I do want to emphasize that that doesn't mean not to upgrade, because there are such huge capabilities in the new sliders that you have in Lightroom 4 that in almost every case you're going to get it even looking better in the new process version. So let me just show you what I would do with this photo if I decided to go and upgrade. So again, I'm going to click the exclamation mark in the after photo. I don't need to review the changes before and after. I already know I want to update, so I'll click update. And I'm going to go back to the loop view by clicking the loop view icon down here. So there I have upgraded that photo. It doesn't have the intense punch it had before, but that's okay, because over here in the basic panel on the right, I'm going to do some things like I'm going to take that highlight slider and drag it all the way over to the left to bring back detail in the highlights. Can you see that down here at the bottom? Let me show you that again a little closer. So the highlight slider was over here like that. See how there's no detail in these waves? If I drag that highlight slider back to the left, look at all that detail that came back. Again, it was like that. Now it's like that. And I also could increase the blacks. So if I drag the black slider over to the left, I can get some of that rich black back in that rock. But I haven't done that, you know, with sacrificing detail in the shadows because the new process version is so good with its highlights and shadows sliders at bringing out detail in highlights and shadows respectively. And then it has all these other sliders too, like clarity and vibrance and saturation that you can work with. So I'm not advocating not to upgrade. I'm just showing you what to do if you decide you do not, how to get back where you were. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So that's what I had to show you tonight about Lightroom 4. And of course, there's always lots more to show. And I have Lightroom on the brain because I just finished doing this course for lynda.com called Up and Running with Lightroom 4. And that's going to be a kind of beginner course, but, you know, it's going to take you where you need to go if you're not familiar with the basics of using Lightroom. Okay, any more things you want to see here before I go back, unshare my screen, and we'll continue with the show? All right, then, here we come.
And I just posted for you lynda.com in the chat and told everyone they have to go there and check out your tutorials. They're awesome.
That's very nice of you, Ron. So great. So the next thing that I would love to do is introduce in more detail our special guest, Rich Harrington. Rich, it's really an honor to have you here tonight. Thank you for taking time. I know you have an incredibly busy schedule, including you're taking off for Photoshop World, aren't you?
Except it's not taking off. It's in my backyard, but yes. I
live
in D.C.
Oh, you lucky boy. Aren't you lucky? That's
no, that actually makes it harder. It's easier to go away to trade shows because then your family doesn't also expect you to do all of those things that you have to get done at the same time. So, but no, it's there's no airplanes involved, but there's twice as much work.
And this is the first time they've had Photoshop World in D.C., is that right?
Yeah, and I hear it's actually extremely well attended, maybe the best attended of any of the places.
Terrific. Well, enjoy. You know, if you guys don't know Rich, although I'm sure many of you do, he has been writing Photoshop books and books about video for a long time. And he also teaches live, he teaches online, he does DVDs, he does courses on lynda.com, he does all kinds of things. And he sort of, well, Rich, maybe you can explain it better, but you kind of cross the line or have one foot on either side of the line between still photography and motion graphics, video, production and post-production. Is that right?
Well, the very first book I wrote was called Photoshop for Nonlinear Editors. It was basically a book for video editors on how to use Photoshop. And that morphed into Photoshop for Video for that book, which is kind of ironic and will be very clear to many of you how ironic that is in the near future. So I've been working in that realm for a long time, doing traditional video production. So I started in journalism. And I worked in print and web, doing online publications and using Adobe products there. But also, the second television station I worked at used Adobe Photoshop as a replacement for what at that time was a $270,000 graphics system for doing on-air graphics. So it was a Quantel paint box. It was the size of a room, literally, and like one person knew how to run it. And so Photoshop was very liberating. This was before Photoshop had layers, let alone editable type. You know, so I learned in an environment that was a broadcast station where we had to produce about 160 graphics a day with no layers, which meant you got really, really, really fast. And then between that and working in newspaper, so I've always been more of a production artist, but I've been doing video for a living and a lot with the DSLR stuff as well. So just finished a new book about DSLR video called Creating DSLR Video. And prior to that, with some friends, worked on a book called From Still to Motion. That was the first book in DVD on using DSLR cameras to create professional video.
Well, I really love your work, and you know, you're one of the few sources out there for the subject of video, you know, in a way that photographers can use and understand. So we really appreciate what you offer us.
Thank you.
I understand you prepared some stuff to show us tonight. Is that right?
Yeah, we're going to actually do some straight Photoshop stuff for everyone's enjoyment, but if the chat room wants it, we can also open up a video clip into Photoshop and show how we can do some stuff there too. But I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. I just have to figure out how to get the window to zoom back. There it is, screen share. And I'll choose my desktop. And
he's gone.
This is what I mentioned earlier, Keith, that when we were in a regular Hangout, he dropped.
He was having problems. Yeah, it might be tied to the problems he was having with his mic, too. He might have a general PC problem.
But we'll give him a little bit of time. So I thought it was interesting to hear how he learned Photoshop in a really practical environment, one that may be different from the way that we use it.
Oh, he's coming back. He's coming back.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Photo of him is back. Well, so while we're waiting for him to come back, I'm curious. I know, Mark, what do you use Photoshop for?
I do a lot of compositing work. I do a lot of photo manipulation, adding things together, a lot of layering and things like that. I use a lot to actually, today is Movie Mashup Tuesday, which I co-curate with three others on G+, and I do almost all of it in there, where we take someone, a random victim on G+, and actually insert them into a movie poster of some sort. So their face becomes part of the poster. And it's a lot of fun, and a lot of people are starting to really catch on to it and have a lot of fun with it. So I use it mostly for, like I said, compositing. I use Lightroom as well, but the majority of it, of the composite work I do, is all done in Photoshop. So, but I do start in Lightroom, collect up my images, and then jump over to Photoshop to finish them out. So.
And your final product is movie posters, you said, mostly?
They're movie posters. Yeah, I'll pull up a link and show you. You can look through them.
Can you show us one?
Sorry to interrupt. Can you guys see my Photoshop screen or not?
We can't. Well, it's gray, but we can see something.
Yeah, there's a... Okay, sorry about that. It doesn't... even though we rehearsed going through the desktop path, that crashes it every time, but choosing Photoshop directly seems happy. Apparently, the Google engineers rewrote the code since the hour and a half before that we just did a test. So let's give it a shot. I'm very sorry to interrupt. Is it okay if I start?
Oh, please. Mark, can you hold on? We will look
at it. Absolutely.
Okay. So I just want to focus today on some non-destructive color correction and how easy it is to fix things. And all the stuff I'm going to do is completely non-permanent. And what I mean by that is that as we make adjustments, it's going to keep the adjustment live. So if you were to go and print and decide, oh, that was a little too much or a little too less, you could just tweak it back. And the big difference with this is that you don't want your images to keep changing and keep getting processed as you work, because those just changes can add up over time and lower the image quality, sort of like making a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy. So I'm just going to open up a photo here, and this is just a simple exterior, and what I want to show you is that it could be a lot better a lot more quickly. So I'm using the standard workspace under Window Workspace Essentials, and I could always reset that if things don't look right. And it's the adjustments panel here that's going to come in handy. I want to use a curves adjustment, which is an adjustment that a lot of people don't use because it's a little intimidating. You get this line and you don't know where to click. But if you just take the little tool that looks like a pointed finger with an up and down arrow, this allows you to come over to your image, and when you click, it automatically adds a control point. So if I pull down, those skies can get a little darker and dramatic. And then if I come over here to this building that's a little dark and I click and I lift up, that can get a little brighter. And so it becomes very quick and easy to get a little bit of contrast in that image, especially in the clouds. Now,
Rich, your resolution is pretty high, so it's a little hard maybe for people to see where you're clicking. So I just want to emphasize that that clicking you did was not on a curve. It was on the image itself, correct?
Yeah, I'll go ahead and change screen resolution. Hopefully that won't crash us. Let's see if that works.
I've been using 1280 by 800 or 720, whichever you got.
Okay. I just switched that. We'll give that a shot. And let's just go ahead there. And you can see that. And so let's just reset that. And we'll do that again. With the On Image tool, I can simply click inside the image. It's a little up and down arrow. And as I drag, it's affecting that area. So we can go ahead and very quickly adjust those skies. So that makes it really easy. But the real cool thing is that if you first make a selection, you don't have to adjust the whole image at once. So we could just take the quick selection tool which is the replacement for the Tragic Wand. You want to give that tool up. And this has been around in Photoshop for about 4 years. And it's nice because if you just start to click and drag through, it will intelligently find all the edges. And look how quickly that found everything. And so it becomes really easy to quickly make a selection. And we can always click the Refine button and turn on Smart Radius. And it's almost instantly perfect. Do you see how with just two clicks there, we were able to select everything in the sky? So now I'll do the same thing. Click the Curves button. And with the On Image tool, if I click on those clouds, I could start to pull down and put a lot more drama back in that sky. And that's looking a lot better. Is that easier to see, Jan?
Great.
Okay. So I want to add another non-destructive adjustment to help this image out. And if I click the back arrow at the bottom of the adjustments panel, I'm going to use vibrance. But before I do it, I want to show you why. Most people intelligently and accurately say, oh, I want saturation. So they choose the hue saturation adjustment. But when you drag up saturation, the colors posterize. Mm-hmm. And so if you're going for that sort of pop art look, that's great, but usually not so good. So on the other hand, we'll just discard that. If I use vibrance, there's a vibrance and a saturation adjustment. People are like, well, wasn't there already saturation? I call this one saturation 2.0, which means that as I drag it, it doesn't posterize like the other one. So even though that's 100%, it boosted the color. And if I don't want to boost the reds, the vibrance slider will boost the non-skin tones. So you can go after the blue skies independently of all those brick reds and sort of have two levels of control for saturation. And that lets you very quickly fill that in. And then if you just want to be a little bit lazy, you can grab curves again and click the auto button, and it will go through and very quickly analyze the image and fix it. And then you can just control that by dragging the opacity slider to back it off and down. That's what I really like about the opacity slider. If I were to print this and it was a little too bright, I could just fade that slider back and hit print again, or save it for the web and get a good idea of what's happening. Any questions on that one before we jump to another picture or comments, Jan, things you want to add?
So when you are reducing the opacity of an adjustment, you're basically lowering the strength of the adjustment. You're not actually reducing the opacity of any of the image elements.
Nope, you're just sort of fading it off. So it's sort of like turning the volume down on that adjustment. It just blends it back with the original. And it's a very flexible way to go in there. And that's what I like about these adjustment layers. They can be masked. They can be faded. You can even do cool things like this with an adjustment. We can go ahead and toss on. I'll do another photo here. And I'll show you a fun thing here. So with that adjustment layer, let's say I wanted to do a black and white adjustment. These adjustment layers also have blending modes. So if I do a black and white adjustment, I say, oh, that's looking pretty good. I could set this to lighten mode. And now, anything I drag to the right will go away. And to the left comes in more presence. So I can say, oh, leave a lot of those reds and pinks in there, but get rid of all the greens and the blues, and you can instantly do a very quick spot color effect, leaving just some colors behind and getting rid of others. And so there we instantly popped the flamingo to black and white, and let, you know, by leaving its color, but got rid of everything else. And so these adjustments are super flexible because they let you use the secret sauce here of adjustment layers and blending modes, so you can mix their results back with the original with just a couple of clicks.
So what's a blending mode?
A blending mode is extremely confusing in the point of view that they have these incredibly long definitions in the help menu, but basically it mixes the layer with the layer below based on the value. So if we take a simple dark photo here and I just say, you know what, let's take a dark picture and I'm going to copy that and duplicate it, and I put a copy on top of itself. If I set that to any of these darken modes, it's going to make the image darker by mixing its values together. Like there's multiply. And so this darker parts of the image were combined with the one below. If I set that to lighten, it's going to start to brighten the areas down below. And so it's just essentially mixing. And this comes in really handy when you start to play with things like, let's add a gradient, and I could go ahead and toss on a nice copper gradient using just the gradient pop-up. And we could say, oh, put that in a blending mode of hue. And it will map that to the photo below, like a really nice complex sepia tone, giving you a really nice tinted image. Or go ahead and put that in color, and it's a little more intense. But it's a way of using two layers and telling them to mix together. So it's like the ultimate food processor with lots of different buttons. And if you really try to understand what every button did, you'd be reading the manual forever. But if you just go, you know what, I'll just experiment. Oh, that looks cool. I like that. Or go ahead and let's put that on in soft light. Oh, that looks nice too. It's just a way to try mixing things together. And if you want to cheat, you can always just select the layer and with the move tool, use a shortcut of shift minus, and it goes through the blending modes one at a time. Or shift plus, it goes through the other way. So you could just sit there and mix them and experiment until you find something you like. Okay? Is that all right, Jan? Can we go on to a new image, or you want to talk through anything of these?
I like it. What do you guys think? Do you understand? Is it too much? Is it too little? Would you do all of that?
That's
amazing.
Something that I've been working with a lot recently is the blend modes, and working with the ability, the newly discovered ability to use that little tool that you click on your image and slide up and down to control items like in the levels panel.
Yeah. It's a total cheat.
Yeah, it is, but it makes things so fast. When I discovered it was like hit yourself on the forehead.
Yeah. Yeah. There's no reason to work harder than you have to work. That's so right.
What I like about this is this kind of connects to even with last week's guest John Paul, who's a very creative fine artist with photography and uses a lot of these techniques in his own images. So it's a real tie-in to creating more artistic interpretation of the photographs.
Very cool. So let's show doing a darkening selectively of an image. So I've got a very cute subject here, and I want to darken the background down. This is a what is this? This is a red fox from like China.
It's another red panda.
There we go.
Yeah.
They're cute, aren't they? So let's go ahead and darken everything else. So we can go ahead and simply take our quick selection tool and select the panda. And I'm just dragging through. And I don't have to be super perfect here. And as I drag, it makes a pretty good selection. And then all I'll do is click the refine button. If it gets too much, you can hold down the option or the alt key and subtract away problem areas. So now I'll just click refine, turn on the smart radius and crank it up, and it got the panda. So that's all it takes to make a really good selection these days with Photoshop is drag with the quick selection tool and then refine it. Now I'm being overly simplistic. There's lots of other tough situations here, but with many images like this, if you just want to make a quick selection, it's that simple. And I could say, make that a selection. So when I click OK, there's the animal loaded. So now we can inverse that selection. So what I did there was it was easier to choose our subject and reverse it. Over in our adjustments panel, we can now use an exposure adjustment and simply darken down the background to put more emphasis on our subject. You know, I shot this at 1 o'clock in the afternoon and the background was way too bright. And I just want to knock that down a little bit. And I could do that, playing with gamma a little bit and exposure. And that just makes it draw the attention to our subject.
If now, I want to... Question for you.
Yeah.
Before this feature came out, how long would this have taken you against a hair background like this?
I'm not a normal person. I've been doing it for years, so it would take me about a minute and a half. But it would take most people about 10 to 15 minutes.
Yeah.
So the quick selection tool and the Refine Edge, which started coming out in CS5, actually CS4, I believe, it was pretty nice. So we've had this technology for a few years, but people have to break themselves of their tragic wand habit.
Yeah, because for me personally, I mean, I was really poor. I never really got involved with the newer technology until recently. And that would have taken me in an older version or even in the GIMP hours on a hair background like that.
And we could take this even further, right? Like, you know, we've already done the hard work of making the selection. So if we just right-click on the background, I'm going to make it a smart object. And now all of my filters can be used non-destructively. So this means I could just choose select, reselect. It reloads my last selection. And I could do things like, let's go ahead and put on a little bit of a Gaussian blur. And so now we can go ahead and defocus the background further. And what that's allowing us to do is we've blurred and defocused the background to further pop our subject. And at any point, you could just double-click on that Gaussian blur and tweak its amount, increasing it, click OK, and it updates. And so not only do you have all of these adjustments, but if you right-click on a layer, you can convert it to a smart object, which basically sticks the original layer in a container and lets you use about two-thirds of your filters on the image. Did that make sense to folks? Questions on why we did that or how we did it? I could run it again, too.
Well, what I see you... Oh, sorry. I was going to say, the theme that I see all of these things going to, correct me if I'm wrong, is these are all ways to adjust your image without messing up the original photo. Everything you've showed us is floating around either in adjustment layers above the photo or hanging down on the bottom of a layer that you've turned into a smart object, and those hanging down smart filters, but nothing is really changing the photo, right?
Correct. Now that computers are so fast, we have really rarely a reason to work destructively, because the way that this looks in on the web, on a Google Plus page, maybe you want to crank the blur for that, but then when you print it, it might be too much. So having that ability to make little tweaks to your image is really nice. And, you know, things stay pretty cool like that. And, you know, we could go a step further. I could, you know, simply reload that selection. And I love this shortcut. Whatever your last selection was, if you just choose reselect, it loads it again. So that makes it really simple to get that in there. So I could say, oh, that's great. And let's put on a vibrance adjustment and just pull down the color a little bit. I'm finding the color of the background too strong. Those greens were distracting. So let's pull that down a little. And, you know, I could find that balance there. So my subject pops. So if you look at where we started to where we ended up, it's the same picture. It's just it has different weight to the viewer, and it's easier for them to focus on the subject. We've guided their eyes to what we want them to see.
What were you going to say before, Ron?
What I was going to ask was, when you're using a smart object, when the little thing drops down like Gaussian blur or another adjustment, does that individual adjustment have an opacity of its own, or do you have to do a global opacity adjustment?
If you click this little double arrow, it pops up with an opacity slider, so you can back it off.
Yeah.
Or you can also change its blending mode. So one of the things I'll often do is a little dirty trick like this, where I'll choose select all, and then I'll say copy merged. And this lets me paste a copy of the whole image on top of itself. It's like I flattened it, but I didn't flatten it.
Yeah.
And so now we can go ahead and do things like run a Gaussian blur on that. And what's cool is you can use that, you know, that's a smart object. So if we run a Gaussian blur on that layer, it becomes customizable. So I can crank that up and say, oh, okay. And you're like, why in the world would you blur it that much? Well, if I double-click that little blending arrow, I could do things like put that into soft light and adjust the opacity a little bit, and it's going to start to behave like a Pro Mist filter, where it's going to bloom the image a little bit. Oh, sorry, as this does this silly little calendar pop-up. There we go. And what
You know what? Wait, Rich, you know what? We can't see that the fade box, the fade dot
really?
At all.
Okay.
Nope.
Oh, well, all right. Let me try. I'm afraid
it's
to
not
choose.
You. It's Google Plus. That's right.
Well, yeah. Okay, so when you click the little double arrow, a box comes up, and it has the ability to change the opacity and change the mode. So do you notice there the end result? Basically, that was a Gaussian blur set to 60% opacity and soft light mode, and it just warms all the colors up and gets rid of some of the noise and gives it just this beautiful tone in the image.
Wow.
So you see there how like it's just really making the fur pop nicely, and some of the noise and the little stray hairs are sort of hidden.
Yeah.
So it's just a nice, simple way of doing that. Now let me do an easier image if I have time. Do I have time for one more photo, Jen?
I don't know. We have to ask Keith. Keith, how long do we have?
Hold on a second. We have about 20 minutes.
Oh, sure.
Then I'm going at a good pace. All right.
Well, actually, Rich, we don't have 20 minutes to do this. We have maybe 10 minutes to do this.
Okay.
Just in case people have questions from the chat room and such.
Sure. So let's do something where we want to change the color of something, and this will show all these techniques together. So one of my favorite choices is select color range, which is one of those tools people don't use, and it allows you to click. And if you just hold down the shift key, you can make a quick selection. And basically, all I did there was selected the yellow.
We're not seeing that either. We can't see that either.
Oh, good Lord. All right, I'll just stay away from selections then, Jen.
You know what it is? It's because we're not in the desktop view. We're in that Photoshop view.
If I switch to that, should we see if it crashes or if it works?
Sure, if you want to.
All right, let's try desktop. If it crashes, then I won't do it. Share, maybe. Take two, select color range. Does it show up?
There we go.
Good. So if I hold down the shift key, I can go ahead and make a quick selection, click OK, and now we could do things like, make a hue adjustment, and we can roll the hue to whatever we want. So I like that color, and that's working pretty well. I say, okay, that's working pretty well, but let's go ahead and start to make this a little more saturated. So we'll do a curves adjustment, and I'm going to pull down the blacks with the On Image tool there just to make those blacks nice and rich. Click on the white star and pull up, and the white star gets brighter. And that's that On Image tool in action, letting you just click where you want to click. Since we didn't do that earlier, let me show this. I'll do this last step again from our previous image so you could see that happening. All I did was I selected everything, copied it by choosing Copy Merged, and then paste. And Trish and Chris Meyer, who do a lot of motion graphics work, they actually call this technique instant sex. And basically, it's converting this to a smart object or using a copy. And now, when you run the filter, up pops the filter box, and I can crank that up nice and heavy. And you see the little double arrow there next to the filter name?
Yeah.
Clicking that brings up a dialog that allows you to change the opacity if you need to back it off, and allows us to change the blending mode to something nice like soft light. And so that's what gives you that really nice sort of filmic look with the really pretty highlights. And if we toggle that off and on, I really like using that smart object trick with the Gaussian blur and blending it. It just does a really great job of popping the contrast and really making the image stand out. Okay. So that's sort of, you tell me, Jan, we have about 6 minutes left by the time you gave me before.
Well, I'm interested to know if any of these panelists have tried these things, are likely to use these things. You know, it's funny, I don't know about you, Rich, but from the, standing at the front of the room view, all these things fascinate me. And then I think, I wonder if people use them. I'd like to know. Helen, what about you?
I use them. I use them quite a bit. And in fact, when I learn a new trick, it'll change the way I edit my next picture because I really want to try something new. I love experimenting with all these and the blending modes and the opacities and the smart filters. It's just great. I'm amazed how much you can do and what great effects you can get.
That's great. Well, then it's wonderful to hear this for Rich to share this with us.
I'll do a down and dirty one then, which is if you add a gradient and you can go from black to white, here's a really cool thing. You instantly have a power window. So a power window, if we set that to multiply, so basically all I did was I made a new gradient and I said use black and white. And now you can change its shape, you can adjust the size and the angle, but because of blending modes and how powerful they are, multiply drops out the whites. And so it's like an instant Lightroom style vignette. You can adjust the scale, you can adjust the opacity, but you've got the ability to do vignettes. And what most people forget is if you just click in the window here, you can move it around to reposition it because that adjustment layer is live. So it's like a little spotlight, and you can just click and drag around to affect it. And that's a nice way to sort of darken your edges and put the viewer's focus where you want. And as you asked before, you can always use that opacity slider to back it off a little bit so it doesn't look like a bad effect. And so that, plus a little vibrance, all of a sudden our image goes from being kind of flat and overexposed to having a little bit more directionality to it and a little bit more richness in the color.
And then can you get back into that gradient and tweak it even more, right?
Yeah,
in the gradient?
Just double-click it, and the gradient pops up. You can adjust its angle. You can adjust the scale, you know, so you can affect the size of it. And if you just want to move it, you just click on the image and drag left or right or up and down, and you can move it to wherever you want to. So it's fully editable, and it's really kind of nice like that. So I'll use that all the time if I want to go ahead and sort of tone down an image like this. I might just toss on a gradient and use the black to white gradient and say, oh, that's good, reverse the angle, start a little bit darker, notice how we could drag that up and down. And this is basically a neutral gradient filter, like a gradiated filter for the sky. So if we just set that to multiply, it's darkening down the sky, and you can adjust the opacity of it, and you've got a gradient filter. So there I darkened the sky, and it stayed bright at the bottom, and it's a very easy way to tone down the top of an image and have it blend back to itself.
So there's this question from the chat, Richard. The question is, can you also duplicate a gradient?
Yeah, you can have as many as you want. So I just click gradient here, and maybe I put one going from the bottom as a black to white, or a black to clear is fine, you know, and you can set the angle for that and drag it over. I say, okay, that one's up there, and then I say, oh, I'd also like another one. I could just duplicate that. There it is. Double click on it, and I'll say make that radial, and just adjust where it's coming from. There it is. Reverse. Adjust the scale. Total control. Everyone has their own opacity, so if you want to do really complex gradients, you absolutely can do that and use that as a way to sort of tone and burn your edges for a picture.
Mm-hmm. So I kind of think of what are they called, fill layers, like
yep.
The gradient fill, the solid color fill, there's a pattern fill, that they're just like adjustment layers in that they are non-destructive, they float above the image, and you can go back in and re-edit them all the time. They're just not photographic adjustments that you find in the, you know, that you think of, like exposure and contrast and such, right?
Yeah, they do a great job of letting you make changes, and they are fills. So when you look at them, there's just a couple of other ones down there, and, you know, basically it's like, I want to go ahead and add a solid color, a gradient, or a pattern. And you bring up pattern, and I think it's worth just showing it really quick. Pattern has the world's worst preset. and I mean, it's a tight match, but Photoshop engineers are sort of known of like, let's show everything it could possibly do. And so you would run this, and you would immediately go, I would never use that. But if you click, and then you go, oh, I would never use that. And you would immediately stop thinking that this is a worthless feature. But if you just come over and click the little submenu, you'll see all these things, and there's great ones like artist surface or grayscale paper. So I can click OK and add that, and I've got all these great paper textures. You know, let's see, I'm going to pick one that's a little bit stronger so you can see it. Does that read OK on the system, or does that show up OK?
The other one?
OK, a little stronger. You could scale that up, and then look, there you really see the texture, right? And we'll just say, oh, that's great. Let's go ahead and, with our move tool selected, I don't know what blending mode I want. I can just use the keyboard shortcuts of Shift Plus and start to step through. It's like, oh, I kind of like that, just a little strong. Let's back that off. And it instantly looks like this is printed on a paper surface. Or I could put it really hard and, you know, use something like hard light and make this look really distressed. And so you've got all these great blending modes, and you could start to take these built-in seamless pattern textures, and just like those gradient layers that were really flexible, you say, oh, that's good, too strong, back it off a little bit, and then you use this on another picture, and you go, oh, wait a minute, that looks just like the other one. If you double-click, just like the gradient, you could drag and reposition that seamless texture and use a different part of it, so it's totally different. So you can randomize this up so it doesn't look like you laid the same piece of paper on top of every one of your distressed photo looks. So I got that, I right click, I could just say, you know, let's go ahead and copy that, or there we go, find it there, and I'll just go to my two image view, there we go, and I could just drag that right over here, and there it is on that image. So it becomes really easy, or right over here. And you see how quick that is to go ahead and apply that texture to other images. And I really like it in that case. You know, that look at what that did to that image. We went from a perfectly fine but boring photo to a little bit more drama and some texture. And if it's too strong or whatnot, we could just tweak that until it gives us the look we want. And it's just a lot of fun. Blending modes are those things that most people get afraid of. And all these great layers down here, so many of these adjustment layers look obnoxious. Like, you choose gradient map, you're like, oh, I'd never use that. But if you go, oh, well, what about if I choose the nice metals? I say, okay, and let's use silver. And I say, oh, that's looking kind of cool, and let's tone that down. Let's try soft light. Or we just step through, and you start to see that all these modes do very different things. And look at that. Divide's kind of cool. Or you start to play with these, and you just get a little bit of an age, darken. It's just fun what you can do with these, and you want to start to stack them and really explore what they can do. And if you find one that you think you like or you're not sure, there's a whole wealth of gradients in here. So if you, you know, just want something really subtle, you can go ahead and toss some of those on and, you know, play with their blending modes. And there's all sorts of fun things these things will do. And these could just be used to tone the image, like something gentle, like hue. And look at how we use that purple and orange gradient, mapped it to our image. And if these were our client's colors or a product that we were trying to unify this for, say, the cover of a catalog, all of a sudden now we've simplified the image down, and we've taken just a really basic, simple image, tossed on a little bit of a gradient, darken the edges, laid on that paper texture, pop the colors, and then use a gradient map to tint the image. Gradient map is like the, if you like duotones and sepia tones and tritones, gradient maps are so much easier. And you just put them in hue or color mode, and you get these beautiful, really elegant images that are just awesome and have these great subtle hues and tones.
That's really beautiful, and that's, I love this idea of using the built-in patterns as textures, because it means I don't have to run around and try to download all these stock photography textures or scan.
And if you don't like
whatever.
It, you double-click, twirl it down, try a different texture. And you can, there's places you can go to load more. You know, you can easily find these online. There's a whole bunch on Photoshop's website, on the Photoshop.com website, but totally changing that up or just dragging within the image to reposition it. And go ahead.
Alan Shapiro does a lot with textures and blend modes. He does quite a lot of really nice work. And he shoots a lot of his own textures as well and created quite a library of them for himself. So that's something else you could do is when you're out walking and you see some cool...
When you're out on vacation and you take out your iPhone and you make sure you collect at least 20 textures a day, boy, that might be billable or deductible work.
It might be. Boy, good thought.
So, yeah, I'm actually going to have to post this. This is one of those happy, I call this creative serendipity, when you're just sort of doodling and it works. I'm actually happy with this image now. I like it a lot better than the original.
There's a lot of people in the chat going, oh, purple, because... Maybe you love purple.
Yes.
No one's going to
believe that a guy made this, but you know, hey, life goes on.
Yeah.
So you guys can see that Rich totally knows his thing here. So here you are confronted with this guy who can tell you anything you want to know in Photoshop. Go at him. What do you need to know?
I'm trying to digest how I'm going to put all this into my workflow and still have time for Google.
What's the least expensive way to purchase it?
To purchase Photoshop?
Upgrade.
Good question.
Yeah. So actually, probably the best way right now is, my understanding is that there's some CS5.5 specials out there, and you know, running at a discount. But now they're offering upgrade protection for CS6. So that's probably the best way. Although, if you do find somebody who wants to sell an older version of Photoshop, it has to be within CS4. CS3, 4, or 5 can upgrade to 6, I believe. But they do have to do a legal transfer of ownership form to you. I see people selling computers with software all the time, and if it doesn't have, if they don't do a transfer of ownership form from Adobe's website, they're not actually selling you the software.
And I have to say, I am really, you know, a big advocate of people buying this software because, hey, I want them to continue to make it cooler and cooler every time. And it's a company. They have to pay their employees and all that stuff. So, you know, it's not that expensive.
Actually, and to that point, Creative Cloud is coming out, and they've announced some details about pricing, I believe, already, which is saying that it's $50 a month for the entire Creative Suite. I've also heard rumblings that there will be variations on that for individual apps at lower prices. So the new version of Lightroom came out, and they released that at a lower price. So there definitely seems to be an awareness at Adobe of having more flexibility in pricing and options. So hopefully that will help.
I have a question from the chat. Beauty Bubble wants to know, let me get back to the question here. Can images be morphed?
You have Liquify, so yes. I mean, we can do things. I mean, if you're trying to go from one image to another, After Effects, which is a companion application in the Creative Suite, lets you create animations like that. So if you're trying to do a morphing animation from one photo to another, that can be done with Adobe After Effects. But if you just want to push the details in a photo around, you've got a couple of ways of doing that. Let me just call up a real quick image here, and I'll show that, which is, because when people say warp, they sometimes mean different things. Photoshop has a tool called the Puppet Tool, and this can be pretty flexible for, yeah. So let me open up, I've got a shot here of an elephant that's a good candidate for this, and let me just open that up real quick. And so here we have an image, and let's just select that. I grabbed the wrong one. Where did it go? There it is, Puppet. Find you. Where's my elephant? I thought I had it. This is the figure. So just one second here, make sure I get the right elephant. Puppet. It's hiding. Oh, well, I'll do it real quick. So you can use a selection tool, and when you have that, it does a great job of processing it and turning it into a image that you can bend or morph or push around. So I found the image. Here it is. Do you all see the elephant there?
Yeah.
Okay. So I've used the quick selection tool, and basically it looked like this. So let's say we had a selection of an elephant. All I did was I cut that elephant out from the background, and that just made it easier to work with. I don't know why Photoshop's being weird there. But it's on its own layer. And I used the Content Aware Fill command to remove it from the background, so that's what it put in the background. Now, if you select the elephant, you can go ahead and use the Puppet Warp. And this basically has you apply pins and mesh, and it'll go through and trace the image. I recommend that you change the mesh density to more points. And now you can start to click on the image to add these control pins. So I can add a pin here on the tummy and on the back and on the buttocks. And I'll put some here. And these are basically handles. So we can do things like lift its shoulders a little bit and give it a little bit of a tummy tuck.
Isn't that amazing?
You know, and then I can say, okay, that's getting pretty good. Let's just pull that leg down. But that leg should be back a little bit. He's standing in a rude position. And you know what? I'd really like the trunk to be up.
That's awesome.
Put a pin here, pull that back down, pull this one down. And what you've actually got that's kind of cool is as you bend this here, notice there, that went behind the pins. I could raise that by clicking the pin depth button and move it up and down the stack. So like in this case, it goes behind one tusk and in front of the other.
Now that's worth the price of admission.
And when you click return, we have a much happier elephant whose trunk is erect, has a strong, good back posture, is standing politely for the lady elephant, and doesn't have a saggy belly. So things will be good in the animal kingdom. I had already removed it from the background and used content to where it fit, so I just had the elephant on its own layer. So I cut it out using the earlier when we did a quick selection tool. I'd already cut him out. So he was on his own layer.
Photoshop has all these other sides besides just adjusting your photos. You know, you can use it for illustration and animation. And there goes our elephant leaving.
There you go.
But I'm sure you love this, Mark, right?
Oh, yeah. I've actually used it on several occasions and animating as well. So with it, yeah, I love the Puppet Warp tool.
Yeah. After Effects has the ability to do the same sort of thing. And After Effects is a companion application with Photoshop. But it has Puppet Warp, and we do this all the time where you can actually, Puppet Tool, and you could take photos that you've built in Photoshop and animate them using Puppet Warp, and it just does a great job of turning these into combination animations. So let's see here if I have it. I probably don't have it. Oh, I do. Here we go. Let me just open this up. And this is a movie, and we've posted this. It's on YouTube. You can find it. Hopefully this won't crash Google Plus. How many things can we make it do at once? But I'm going to turn the sound down on this. And basically, these two hands were in a photo, and I cut them out in Photoshop. Then in After Effects, I use a very similar tool to add pins, and I could bend the hands together. And basically, you see there that there's the pins, just like you saw in Photoshop. And then you can go through, and because After Effects has a timeline, you can create a little animated timeline. So we did the same thing here with the bird. Click and add a couple of pins on its head and its body. And then you can sketch that so that you can actually play that back and create a fluid animation, you know, and basically make it look like it's alive. So you can combine Photoshop with the companion application of After Effects in the Creative Suite to actually create photo-based animations, and these two tools work together. So After Effects actually had this tool first, and then it made its way into Photoshop, and if you use the two together, you could do really cool, fun things like that to make animated movies out of your photos.
Yeah, well, I've always called it After Effects Photoshop on crack. That's always what I've affectionately referred to it as, because it's awesome like that.
So Jan, we're at an hour, but we can keep going for another 20, 25 minutes if you'd like.
And it will still be broadcast and recorded and all that good stuff? Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I was going to say, Rich, I would love it if you would come back sometime and show us some more motion graphics stuff.
Sure.
And how Photoshop integrates with these other Creative Suite applications. I think more and more people are getting into that. It used to be just a rarefied world, but now, you know, video's everywhere. And I don't know, do you at least shoot video? Is that one way
to... I shoot very limited video. I bought my first DSLR with video with the intent of shooting it while I was on trips. But I'm still a bit intimidated by it, and do I need new software? So I think having you back on the show to discuss that would really help people demystify the whole shooting DSLR video.
I think in a little bit of time we'll have some good stuff to talk about on that.
Yeah. Okay.
Fingers crossed.
Yeah.
What's the chat room have to say, Ron?
I don't know, but Keith said I never shoot video.
I shot video with my flip camera until my daughter's dropped it in the toilet. Now I can't use it anymore. So
I was being sarcastic. It's pretty much all I shoot is video.
I know. Although you have
okay, I have a video question for you. This is my big chance to talk to Rich because he's so busy. I never get to talk to him. So if I do want to just create like consumer level video, nothing fancy, I just want to put it on my YouTube thing or something, you know, what is the best format for that?
Well, if you want the easiest camera to shoot with, it's not a DSLR. You know, there are lots of other easier cameras. The weakness on a lot of video cameras is the audio side. So I would just make sure you have a camera that you can plug a microphone into. And if you're editing with, say, Adobe Premiere, or if you're editing with, you know, an application like iMovie or Windows Movie Maker, most of those can pull in those formats from most modern cameras and work with them right away. When you're done, you'll just export what's typically referred to as an H.264 file, and you'll find useful presets, sometimes for YouTube directly, or presets that say things like Apple iPad. And because of Apple's domination in the consumer electronics space, everyone pretty much supports the Apple iPad format for video, which is a nice, friendly way to take HD video and make it ready for the web. So when you go to hit upload, it doesn't take forever to post, and it doesn't actually even do much to your video since it's already optimized for the web. So it uploads, you know, 35 times quicker because it's that much smaller, and it takes a lot less time before it's ready to be served. So just save for Apple TV or save for a YouTube preset. If you have iTunes or you have QuickTime Player and you can open up a movie, you could just choose File, Export, and choose the Apple TV preset right there from what's built in, and that's on Mac or PC.
Right, I know you have all those presets, and I do use them, but you know me, I always want to know what's going on underneath, and I can't, you know, I want to know, like, I've always wondered, and I actually took a compression class one time from the master of compression, Ben somebody?
Wagner, yep.
Wagner, exactly. And I couldn't understand. You know, it was too complicated. Like,
I can give you all the short answer, which is, for example, Jan, where you're sitting right now, if your camera wasn't moving much, nothing would have changed in that scene except for you're at the center. So all the stuff at the edge, the computer could just repeat those pixels. And the white walls behind you there, it would just repeat those and say that that is... easy to see, that's the same color. So compression works by looking for repeated pixels, and it's very much like the way that JPEG works. So if you apply heavier compression, you start to get what's called posterization, but basically you start to lose the finer details in the gradient, the colors get simplified, and the file sizes go down. And that's really what happens.
And if I wanted to know more about this, is this stuff in one of your books or all of them?
Almost... Every one of the books that we've done on video always has a chapter on compression. So I'm in the process of working on the Premiere Pro Classroom in a book right now. You'll also find a book called An Editor's Guide to Adobe Premiere Pro. We did a book on Final Cut 10 called From Still to Motion, Final Cut Pro 10. If you're really into video and the web, I actually have a book called Professional Web Video. My company's produced about 5,000, 5,500 web videos at this point. I started doing web video back in 1997. So if you want to know what we've been doing for the last 15 years, that book lays it all out. Although many people read that and go, oh, I mean, it's extremely friendly and we designed it for beginners, but they're like, oh, I just wanted to post to YouTube. And so they don't make it all the way through the book. They stop early.
Right.
So cool. It sounds like you want to know more than the Save For preset, so you might be a good candidate for that book. If you head to my blog and you just go to Richard Harrington blog, I post every day, and if I fall behind, I still catch back up. But there's a whole category that says web video. There's a whole category that says DSLR video, one that says Adobe. So you will find 6.5 years worth of articles neatly organized with videos and things to read, and you know, there's no shortage of material there. So if you, I tell most folks, and I don't mean this in a vain way, if you would just read my blog a couple of times a week, if you're into this stuff and you click on a category, you will, in a few months' time, be a lot, lot smarter. And I'm happy to give all that information away because it comes back in karma.
Cool. I'm putting it in my Google Reader. And I want to know when you sleep.
Not often. Not often. Although I learned a few things from Mr. Scott Kelby on how to be very efficient. I also have a great office with a great staff. So all I have to do is show up and talk, and they record the stuff and put it out, so that's great.
Terrific. Okay, anybody else? Questions?
Yeah, I was going to say from the chat, Beauty Bubble is asking a question, and I'm not quite sure exactly how to answer. She's wondering about how to determine the best canvas size to work on. She said, for an example, I have a photograph I've scanned that came from a family album, but has no idea of the original pixel size. How do I set a canvas size?
Sure. I'm going to show you the easiest, fastest way to do that. If you open up any picture, and she's really doesn't want a canvas size per se, you just open up the picture, choose the crop tool by pressing C, and up at the top here, you have width and height and resolution. And if you click the little drop-down menu, you'll see all sorts of common sizes for things like 8x10, 5x7, 5x4. And what that really comes down to is knowing what you want to do with this picture. If you want to put it in a frame, if you want to put it out to the web. And so if you want to put it in a frame, and maybe that's a 5x7, I could say, oh, wait, that's the wrong one. Flip that, 7x5 at 300. And all I'll do is double-click the background, so it's an actual layer. And as you drag, it forces it to be that correct shape. And it even gives you the little grid for the pixels so you can align using the rule of thirds, which means you place your subject, the primary focal point of your subject, at one of these tic-tac-toe points. And when I'm all set, before hitting apply, I just choose hide instead of delete. So now, even though it cropped, if I needed to, I can go ahead and simply take the move tool, and I still have all those pixels outside of the edge. You see that little ghosted border there, so you could recompose a little bit if you need to and adjust that as necessary. But there's the image, and you don't have to worry about what canvas size. You've simply cropped to your target, in this case, 7x5 at 300 pixels an inch. So you don't have to guess. You don't have to type in random numbers. If you don't know which one to pick under the new dialog and you're starting with an empty canvas, well, you've got all these different categories like web, and there's all the standard web sizes, or you know, including ads for websites, or I'm making a DVD, so film and video, and I could say, oh, I want to make a DVD slideshow, and I could use one of those, or you know, I'm doing print, photo, and there again, you see all those standard sizes. So it really depends on where you're sending it, but there are useful presets both in the crop tool and the new dialog box to take out the guesswork.
Great answer. Thank you.
Other questions? Anybody else?
I think we're in awe right now.
Most people are saying that they you know, I don't think anybody can say they haven't taken one new thing away today, that's for sure.
Well, I have a free podcast series called Understanding Adobe Photoshop, which does these sorts of things each week where, you know, like, for example, on the crop tool you just saw, most people stop and they only know one thing about the crop tool and they don't do any more. And what they don't realize is that there's tons of options. So you could go in with the crop tool and having never used it before, you know, go, oh, well, what else can I do with the crop tool? And there's all sorts of great stuff. So, like, if you've got a perspective problem, it's easy to fix. And people just don't realize that. So let's just do this as an example. Let's say I have a problem and I've got an image like this that's crooked. You know, I've opened up this image. There we go. And, you know, it's all totally crooked. I'll just go ahead and open that. I could take my crop tool and C for crop and start to drag out. And if I knew about it, but a lot of people don't, I could just click this little box that says perspective. Let's just make sure this isn't a smart object. There we go. So I could drag that out, choose my perspective option, and now those points of the crop tool can be moved right to map the points on the image, just like that. And now when I crop, not only has it straightened, but it will remove the distortion in the image too. And so people just don't know that all these things exist, and that's why I wrote the book, Understanding Adobe Photoshop, which is literally came out of teaching college-level Photoshop. Every time I would teach Photoshop in a college classroom, I would get students trying to clep out of it, like get out of taking the class because they had past experience. And I never let a single person come out. I said, If after 2 weeks you don't feel like I've completely changed the way you use Photoshop, and you could prove to me you don't want to be here, I'll let you pass out of it. And everybody just, they learn how to do it one way, and then they stop. And that's why stuff like Jan has on Linda, and you know, with all those different people teaching Photoshop is essential, because you only learn how to do the one thing you need, and you don't realize that while maybe you figured out the crop tool has 7 different modes, and that they all have special purposes that solve problems, and you never touched them because you figured out one thing. It's kind of like, oh, I figured out how to get through the door by jumping through the little top glass window above it. That's how a door works. And you never realize that there's electric doors, and there's doors that automatically open when you got your hands full, and that some doors have security locks, which are great when people show up that you don't want to talk to, and there's lots of different doors. But it's the same thing with Photoshop. The tools have many different ways of being used, but most people only learn one way, and then they stop.
Yeah, I think of Photoshop like a language or like learning a musical instrument. You know, it's a never-ending path. There is almost no way you could know everything. And it's always evolving. And it takes a lot of energy to learn it all and to learn at least the things that you need. And I kind of think that's the beauty of Photoshop, but it's also the downside. Because regular human beings aren't like you and me, Rich, right? I mean, it's not their life. They just want to get the picture looking good, or they need to make the brochure, or whatever it is.
Which is why I say, you know, spend $30 for a month of training in an online site and dig in, or, you know, pick up a book and work your way through. I don't expect people to know these things. I do think, though, that they could subscribe to a free weekly podcast and learn one thing a week and subscribe to a couple other people's podcasts. And if you watch one Photoshop podcast a day, after 3 months, you would literally find yourself twice as fast as you are now, if not 3 times faster.
Yeah.
And, you know, that means two things. It either means that, well, three things. You'll be getting home earlier from your job. You will be more likely to get a raise because your boss will notice how awesome you are. Or if you're doing billable work, you're getting more work done and making more money. And so, you know, speed is incredibly beneficial these days. And so that's why I mentioned earlier at the start of this, I sort of started off as a production artist. I worked in a TV station where we had to turn around 90 to 120 graphics in a day, you know, with people yelling at you and burning fires and police sirens going off, and that was broadcast news. And before that, it was newspaper. So I just love these little tips and tricks, and I just want to know all the fastest ways of doing things. So if with the crop tool I could fix a crooked image and fix keystoning and distortion and remove all sorts of other problems and get it sized to a specific output in one operation, wow, somebody else is going to do that. It's going to take them 9 or 10 steps. And so it's really cool when you learn these little things that the tools do, and suddenly it's not like a contest with yourself, but it's rather, how much earlier can I get home and see my family?
Yeah.
That's right. But the thing, you not only have to watch the podcast or the Google Plus or the lynda.com, you have to practice. You have to try it. I mean, my brain, you know, I can't operate like that where I've got it all in little drawers and just pull it out. I have to have my hand connected to the information. And for me, the way to do that is practice. You know, it gets the pathway to your hand. Anyway, I think we're at a point where we have to switch off the broadcast part of this, but we still can continue to talk to one another if you guys would like to. And the people in the chat room are more than welcome to continue to raise questions. And will this still be on G+, Keith or Ron? Playing on G+ now?
Don't let the after show?
Yeah.
Yes. I have to restart the hangout, but it'll be there as well.
It'll be on the G+ one. It'll be on Vidcast too, right?
Yep, it's always on Vidcast.
If there's anybody who can't join us because of your own obligations at home, we understand, but he's going to restart the broadcast, and then you can sign back in if you can do that. And if you, Rich, thank you so much. That was unbelievable.
Sure, thank you for having